For those of you I've not met before, which is now no one but met very briefly, my name's Jan and I look after the Pentland Centre. And so this is a Pentland Centre talk, and this is Frida, who I work alongside in something called Seafood Business for Ocean Stewardship. So we have a research collaboration, and so she's come over to visit for a few days, and I thought it'd be really nice for you to hear about her journey from very unusual collaborations through to being a PhD student in Stockholm Resilience Centre. So over to you.
Thank you, Jan, and it's really nice to be here, and thank you for the invitation. So I titled this How to Change the World, and then kind of slightly panicked because I'm just like, I don't really know how to change the world, but at least I tried to do my best to change parts of the world. So I'm going to talk you through some of those sort of projects or things that I've been involved in. So if I had to define myself, I would probably say that I'm an activist at heart. So for me, that sort of, it means that I strongly believe in that we can do things much better than what we do today. And that I believe that sort of people and corporations are willing to change, but that it needs someone or something to initiate that change. I have broken the law. I don't take it easily, but I think sometimes that it is necessary. And I think it's also part of sort of where I come from and sort of my own activism has taken me from, as you see from these pictures, from the back of a police van to both poles. I've been to the Arctic multiple times. I've been to Antarctica. I've been discussing with Mr. Jane Rumble, who's the head of the Foreign Office, who deals with UK overseas territories. And the lovely man on the side there is the Icelandic president. So it's been a bit of a varied group of people, but lovely experience in itself. So I'm going to talk you through three things that I've been doing. And one is the Barents Sea work that I've done, which is basically trying to get the Norwegians and Russians to agree on the good outcome. So it's about saving penguins and how you can deal with change in Antarctica, which has a very complicated geopolitical reality. But then also how all that sort of taken me back to school and back to academia. But before, I just want to say something about Greenpeace. So I worked for Greenpeace for a long time. After my master's, that's where I ended up. It's also a place I call home. It's where I started my activism. And Greenpeace, as you know, I think it's a very known brand. It was founded in 71. It's a 50-year-old organization by now in Vancouver and based on protest against nuclear testing on the Amchika Islands. And the ship that they sailed out on, the Phyllis Cormac, was then sort of named Greenpeace, and that's the vessel. So being at sea has always been a strong part of the Greenpeace history. Now, Greenpeace International is based in Amsterdam. And the Greenpeace vessels are flying on the Dutch flag, which is an important part of when you do activities at sea, sort of which flag state you belong to. But it's the Dutch government who looks after Greenpeace vessels, as was noted when the Arctic Sunrise was arrested in Russia and people were held for over 3 months, because it was the Dutch government that then took Russia to court over the illegal arrest and seizure of their vessel in the end. So Greenpeace isn't an independent campaigning organization, independent in the sense that it only has member money from its donors and some large philanthropies, but you cannot give specific money to a specific project. It's a campaigning organization, uses peaceful, creative confrontation. I think in terms of what people perceive as peaceful can of course vary. I think a case of creative confrontation is recently the example in UK waters, when they've been placing boulders to stop trawling in marine protected areas that are being fished. And the idea is to sort of expose global environmental problems and develop solutions and sort of believe in a green and peaceful future. At times, the peace part of Greenpeace has been very strong, especially the anti-nuclear weapon part. Less so recently, but I think everything that goes on in Ukraine and how that links to Greenpeace nuclear work is probably going to increase that part of Greenpeace work. So it depends. It consists of offices around the world. There is some few missing here, sadly, especially in Africa. So it has 55 countries. It's a network of, in some cases, it's a regional office and sometimes it's a national office. For example, I worked for Greenpeace Nordic, which is sort of the Nordic countries combined. But I was based partly in Oslo, but then also in Sweden. It has three ships, the Esperanza, which was decommissioned last year. The biggest one that Greenpeace has ever had, 71 meters, the Arctic Sunrise, which you see on the picture, it's an icebreaker. And then, of course, the Rainbow Warrior. And this is the third Rainbow Warrior. The first one was sank, sadly, in Auckland. The second one, you were almost possible to poke a hole through it, so it had to be commissioned. And now, recently, they also bought a sailing yacht while they're waiting to see if they're going to build a new vessel. But that's sort of, that is Greenpeace. So it's a truly global organization. Works very top down compared to, I think, organizations that are maybe more grassroots and more franchise. Greenpeace has a 80% of what all offices do has to be decided by the global program. So you only have a 20% possibility to sort of adapt to local issues. But that means that if you are going to work on the Amazon rainforest, all offices then combine, like work together on projects related to the Amazon rainforest. And I think that's especially important when we live in a very interconnected world, where we see that paper or pulp, for example, coming from the boreal forest in Sweden or in Canada, gets used as toilet paper in maybe hundreds of countries around the world. So that kind of is part of, I think, what Greenpeace has been very efficient over the years, is that ability to sort of focus. But now I'm going to take you to the Barents Sea. I don't know if you know where that is. It's the sea that lies between the tip of Norway and the Arctic Ocean. And it hosts the largest cod fishery in the world. So if you've had any cod or any haddock lately, it's most likely come from this fishery. This is a very long and sort of wordy title of something. But we had spent a few years in the areas around Svalbard, which is the Arctic sort of archipelago of the Barents Sea. It's halfway between the North Pole and mainland Norway. So we had been there to do science. I'm going to be very honest. If you want to send the ship to the polar regions, your main justification of doing that is doing science. You don't have sort of so many reasons to be there if you don't want to be a tourist. So we had engaged with sea ice scientists and offered our vessels as a platform to conduct sea ice science, especially around the sea ice minimum, because that's a big sort of media event in September. And over the years, we were like, there's quite many fishing vessels in this area. And there were like more and more of them. And as far as 81 degrees, north, and that's very, very far north. So we were sort of, what's going on here? And it doesn't sort of feel right to see these vessels in this area. So we started looking into some of the science on what happens in this area. And it's actually quite dramatic. So we pulled it together and you can look at it, the summer season. So that's the summer, that's sort of when you can fish, basically, because you don't want to fish when there's so much ice, has become 20 weeks longer since the year that I was born. That's sort of quite a long, quite a big change. We could also see that the Barents Sea has lost 50% of its ice cover, which means that there is less sea ice. So the summers were getting longer and there was less sea ice. We also saw that there was an increase in temperature because of what they call Atlantification of the Arctic. It means that more warmer water is coming up, which is a good thing for cod, because cod actually really likes a bit of warmer water. So the sort of the cod stock had also expanded its range in this area. So it was sort of a perfect storm of change that happened in this area. At the same time, we also came across this study, which is like quite super influential. So if you see the red and green and yellow, that's sort of the Institute of Marine Research in Norway, they did sort of seabed surveys and started sort of looking at what kind of diversity that was on the seabed. And the more red you see, the more vulnerable it is. And that could be sea pens or sponges or different kinds of corals, not sort of the coral reefs we see, but sort of cold water coral reefs. And there's quite a lot of red around, and there's also not very much protection in this area. When we look at it, and then what's cool with some of these sea pens is because of polar amplification, they're like 2-3 meters high, so it's like sea pen forests. And if you see them like more further south, they're much, much smaller. So what they also did, this group of researchers, is that they looked at fishing. So where is fishing going on? So that's the second slide, where you see intensity, the more red, the more fishing that was going on. So we could see on Svalbard, there's some, I don't think you see it so well on the map, but you will see that there is some trawling going on around Svalbard. So we then started looking into sort of, but who are these people? Or what are these boats? Who fish there? So it's about 189 licensed trawlers, and they're all of this size. So there's no small boats. So there's no, there's not like a local fishery in any way. This is actually a Kirkella. It's a UK boat. The quota of the cod fishing is split between Norway and Russia, and they have managed this fishery jointly and have done so since the 70s. And they take 19% of the quota. And 10% is then being shared with third countries, and that will be the EU, the Faroes, Iceland, and Greenland. And the catches vary, about 600,000 to 700,000 tons, but it's been as much as 1 million tons of fish. So a lot of fish. But what we also did, what we started to, we asked for information from the Norwegian Fisheries Directorate about landings and where the landings came from. And as you see from this graph, it was very clear that these areas over time had become much more interesting. So these are the areas around Svalbard. It went from being a very small proportion of the fishery to actually coming close to sort of 12% of the landings from Svalbard. But what we also thought, like, sort of, we know sort of where they fish, we know how much they fish, but how do we get from that boat to a supermarket? That's when we looked at Espersen. It might be a company you never heard of, but it's the largest whitefish producer in Europe. And this is a schematic map that we did over the relationship between the fishery and Espersen. And Espersen was particularly interesting because we know that they're the main supplier of fish to McDonald's. So if you ever wonder who reads sustainability reports or corporate reports, I do, because that's when you figure these things out, or trade media. But it was basically to have both the Russian side and the Norwegian side through Havfisk, which is the largest trawling company in Norway, and Ocean Trawlers, or Norebo, as they're now called, is the largest privately owned fishing company in Russia. So there were some big guys involved in this fishery. But we sort of, now we knew who fished, we know how much, we knew where they were because we looked at satellite data, we know how it linked to the market. So we then launched a campaign, and this was probably a year of work, but we didn't do any actions. We sat behind our desks and investigated, and we launched this report that we called This Far No Further. And what we did was that we actually started pointing fingers at who were fishing in this area. So instead of just having intensity of fishing, we color coded it based on the ownership, based on who owned these vessels. So you will see the pink is Norebo, the Russians, and the yellow and orange are the Norwegians. This was very successful. It suddenly became very clear who they were. And the demands were quite simple when we launched this report. It was basically to say, for the fishermen, we don't want you to fish in this area. For the fish buyers, we said, we don't want you to engage with fishers that fish in this area. And the call for the Norwegian government, who can regulate this area, was to protect it. So that was sort of the calls we made at that point. And of course, calling for a whole closure of Svalbard is a bit sort of dreaming big. But if you don't dream big, you will not land in the treetops. That's at least my take on it. So after some very intense negotiations, which included the catching sector and the food processors and retailers, we actually landed this agreement. So this is an agreement between basically sort of between the industry. We were not a part of this agreement, but it was very nice to see them coming together. But it's also nice to see them using this kind of text, because it showed they sort of, they did take it seriously. They all signed onto it, and they also very clearly stated that sort of the precautionary principle was part of this. So we were very happy to see this. They also established their own compliance procedure to make sure that everyone complied with it. And when you look at who actually signed it, for me, it becomes even more impressive. So these were the signatories to this agreement. And I think for anyone in the UK, it's very common household names. And of course, with the big processors being part of this, we also covered mostly all supermarkets in Europe. So we did do, we knew that this fish was also linked to sort of retailers in Germany and in France and so on. But by covering the fishing sector, we basically sort of covered everything. So in 2019, gladly, this voluntary agreement has now been replaced by regulation. So it means that 10 of those areas that are mostly red are now protected permanently from fishing by the Norwegian government. The whole eastern side of Svalbard has its own new regulation that means that you can't expand fishing from a historic footprint until you've done proper environmental impact assessment on the impact on the seabed before. And of course, we didn't get it all protected as we wanted to, but I'm very happy with that was being landed. And also, like, some of the dynamic here was that the industry didn't want to have to self do their own compliance. So they were very keen on pushing on Norway too. It was much more convenient for them to have the Norwegian Coast Guard looking after this agreement than themselves. So, and then of course, everyone loves a bit of big news and great news. It was really nice to see the spread of this news. And that's of course how Greenpeace works, but it also builds that sort of confidence in that we're all doing the right thing. And I think the fishing industry is not used to get good media cover. And I know that this meant a lot to them, that it actually got acknowledged, the work that they done. But that was the Barents Sea. So my next example, we're going south. It's going to be about penguins and protecting Antarctica. I've been to Antarctica twice, and for me, it's like being in Narnia. It's like truly magical, and it's like really world beyond imagination. And sadly, the thing we see about Antarctica is normally kind of not good news. It's doomsday glaciers, emperor penguins are in decline. Basically say it's a done deal without global action, that we're going to lose those species if we don't act. Or the doomsday glacier, if it melts, we're going to say that's going to be a lot. But we also have programs like Frozen Planet, who attracts millions and millions of viewers from around the world. So it's like it's a truly special place. But like, isn't Antarctica protected? Like, yes and no, I think is the answer to that question. So in 1959, 12 nations signed the Antarctic Treaty to safeguard the continent. So that's for peace and scientific purposes only. In 1978, the treaty parties at that time, because then they had expanded from 12 to some more, were concerned about the effects on fishing in the Southern Ocean. And then in 82, they then created the Convention for the Conservation of Antarctic Marine Living Resources, or CAMELAR. And they're actually meeting at the moment in Hobart these two weeks. So the continent is sort of protected for peace and science. The ocean, not so much. That's where it's still allowed with activities. So this is CAMELAR. So the area that CAMELAR has covered, the Southern Ocean, is 10% of the world's oceans. So it has 26 states as of last week, when Ecuador also joined members, and the European Union. So it's like quite many countries that are going to try to agree. And they look at science and fishing and tourism and human activities in the ocean. Of course, in many places, these things overlap. So if you're a tourist and you come on a boat, but you go on land, you will be dealing with both the ocean and you will be dealing on land. So they sort of work in tandem, CAMELAR and the Antarctic Treaty. But CAMELAR governs fishing, and it governs to the point that they agree exactly where and how much they're going to fish, for example. They also agreed in 2012 that they were going to create a network of marine protected areas in the Southern Ocean. This was very forward thinking when it came. It was almost a bit sort of, wow, can this happen? We're going to see a network of marine protected areas in the Southern Ocean. Took a bit of time, and they managed to protect the Ross Sea in 2016. And after that, there's been nothing. Despite having two very, very solid proposals on the table, the Weddell Sea, which its original proposal was, I think, 1.8 square million kilometers. It will be five times the size of Germany if it were to be adopted. And the Domain 1, which is the Antarctic Peninsula. So those proposals are on the table, proposed by nations, supported by science, but countries can't agree, sadly. So we basically only have the Ross Sea and the South Orkneys, which the UK protected by themselves. And of course, the South Sandwich and South Shetland Islands are protected, but that's outside. So, and in parallel to this sort of difficulty to agree, to protect and establish this network of marine protected areas, human activities are also increasingly quite rapidly in Antarctica. And there's traces of human activities everywhere you go. Like this. We collected 5 tons of waste when we were down there. Of course, this major piece in the middle took some of that weight. That's a Yokohama fender, for those who want to know. It's a fender that you put between vessels when they're gonna when vessels go alongside. But there is fishing nets, there are ropes, plastic cans, sachets from noodle packs, mooring lines, buoys, like everywhere. And what was particularly concerning with our trip was that we were there to go to the most remote places that you could go and recount penguin, chinstrap penguins. And we found all of this waste inside penguin colonies, more or less. But also looking at tourism, in 2011, there were about 20,000 tourists that entered Antarctica. About 10 years later, it's 55,000. And that doesn't include the 20,000 people that only go on vessels. So it's expected that that tourism number is going to increase even more. And then we have to remember that it's only 4% of the entire continent, which is barren ground. So there is a lot of competition to actually go ashore in Antarctica. And of course, because of the weather, there's only a few places where you can go ashore. This thing, we actually found on Elephant Island, and we spent the whole day to remove it. So it's now part of a port facility in the Netherlands, because we didn't want to return it back to South America, because we were fearing it we'll go back on a ship again. So we it's in the port of Ijmuiden. they were very happy to get it. But I think that thing contained like over 50 car tires. But of course, one of them, like waste is concerning, but one of the major concerns is, of course, krill fishing, but also toothfish, but mainly krill. So this is a krill fishing vessel. That's the kind of size they are. There's about 11 boats that fish for krill in Antarctica. This is the Dongwon owned vessel, Jan, the Sejong. four nations, it's Chile, Korea, China, and Norway. Norway has by far the largest share of the catches. And it's been an increase in catches. And it's quite interesting to see that we're back to the levels that caused so much concern that they created Gamelar. And we're probably about to exceed those levels. And as you can see from this, they're mostly only fishing in one area, the area that's called 48, which is the same area as the Antarctic Peninsula. So it's an increase in catches, the expanding capacity, potentially, but also by building new boats, which with a new technique that they call eco-harvesting, which means that instead of pulling the trawl up of the water, you keep the trawl in the water and you hold, like you hold, pump it up. So you have like a pump inside the end of the cod end of the trawl, and then you use water to pump it up on deck. And it means that you can have the trawl in about for a week to pump up. So it's a very efficient way of fishing. Could be, not all technology is bad, but of course it has impact. But what we also seen is the concentration of catches. So when you start looking at where they're catching more and in like more specific areas. And they're quite interesting, this fleet, because they follow each other. Because Antarctica is so big, and if they know that someone is heading off to region, if they know that these captains on those boats are good, the others follow. So it's like a cat and mouse chase where they all seem to follow each other around. But sort of how does this relate to penguins? So Antarctica is definitely a place where you can look at land to understand changes in the oceans. And penguins are like the canary in the coal mines, but for the marine ecosystem in Antarctica, they really tell us something about what goes on. And many of the penguin populations are in decline, and specifically those that live on the Antarctic continent. So if you look at the ones like the king penguins that we know from South Georgia, they are like slowly expanding south because their kind of range where they like to be is increasing. And also the gentoo penguins, so they call it gentoofication of Antarctica. But chinstraps, Adelie penguin and king penguins are declining. Penguins are also very vulnerable when they're on land, and they come on land for their sort of the period when they have chicks. And then they all come on land. So it's even penguins that don't necessarily have chicks. They like, oh, my pals are also being on land, so I'm going to follow. So this is a guy called Steve. He's a penguin scientist. And encounter. This is from the Elephant Island. And we were there to count chin straps because they haven't been counted for a very long time, at least not on Elephant Island, 50 years ago, actually. Do you see the, maybe you can't see it, do you see the leopard seal? Yeah. Da, 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 da. There it is, lurking in the sound, very conveniently placed, because the penguins had to cross that little, yeah, to, they're very smart, those. So we used some of the same principle of the work that we did in the Barents Sea. So we launched this report that we called License to Krill, where we then mapped the pattern of the fishing industry, and we overlay that with a proposed MPA from Argentina and Chile. We also engaged very actively with Aker Biomarine, which is the largest Norwegian company who's like built these new vessels, also very outspoken about sustainability and how important that is for them. So we thought that they like, they're the largest, they speak very highly of sustainability. So we therefore want to sort of engage with them. So they knew that we were going to release this, but it clearly shows that like there is a lot of fishing going on inside the areas that are proposed to be protected. At the same time, it was very simple. It was the question to the industry was, stay out of these areas for buyers of these products. That could be everything from Holland and Barrett, who sells krill tablets, to the feed industry, who uses krill meal in their feeds, to not source from companies that are still fishing so much inside or fishing inside these areas. We also know that we had a much tougher geopolitical situation in Antarctica than we faced in the Barents Sea because of the complications around Camelot, and nations has to agree by consensus. And also that we had very little leverage over the Chinese industry in this case. So again, negotiations, some kind of co-production, I'm thinking, in terms of my... we landed in that arc. So Aker Biomarine was very concerned that any agreement would only be for them, so there will be like unfair competition. So they, of course, wanted to see everyone. So they used their power within ARC, which is the Association of Responsible Krill Harvesting Companies, to get ARC together to sign up to this agreement. And they created what we call the voluntary restricted zones. It means that you see the marked areas that are where penguin, they, so gentoos are pink, Adelie is purple, and chin straps are green. And they are not allowed to fish inside those areas during the time when penguins are on land. Sadly, we didn't manage to get Elephant Island into it, because it's a very important fishing ground, but we're working hard to try and get it in this year. And the area where you see like an overlap here, it's an area that they agreed to permanently close for all fishing. And that's Hope Bay and the Antarctic Sound. So now they do stay out. And gladly, so the agreement has been in place since 2017. It consists of an expert panel, which is scientists who are working in Antarctica with different sort of penguin scientists, whale scientists, spatial planning scientists. But this is sort of outside the formal Camelot system. And it has a review panel, which consists of NGOs mainly, but also representatives from ARC, the krill fishing industry. It expires in 2024. Or if the MPA gets adopted. But there is actually already now a renewal process ongoing because the industry is also keen to continue, which has been a bit of a shift and a bit of a change, which is sort of really nice. There is a 99.5 compliance. One vessel managed last season to fish inside the area, panicked. We're in there for, like, you know, 11 hours. Sent this like, we're so sorry email. And how they had informed the captain, and we were not going to do this again. But it shows something about sort of the honesty that they actually admit. And it's been very important, I think, particularly working with industries which are hard to reach, like the Chinese, that you see that people are open and honest about, because mistakes happen. So it shouldn't be in any way punished. And it's also been mentioned, at least in one scientific paper, and I think hopefully there will be more to come, that talks a bit as sort of at this voluntary initiative can sort of help to reduce negative impacts on penguins. And there's been another paper also coming out quite recently that also looks at the importance of having not having fishing around penguins when they are on land. So that's super nice. And hopefully we'll get Elephant Island at some point. It would be great. The Elephant Island chinstrap penguins have been reduced since 71 to when we counted them in 2020. They've been reduced with close to 70%. So it's a massive decline in chinstrap penguins on that island. So why did I leave all this done? I've been to the Arctic, I've been to Antarctica. And here I am, I'm like 43, a PhD student. But what brought me here from a ship to a desk is actually a scientific idea. So the guy on the Henrik over here is a person I've known. We're both Swedish, I've known him for a while. And I think this work that he's done has been truly influential in how I also see the world. And that was the work they did around keystone actors. So what is a keystone actor? So this is how it's being defined by Henrik and the way we work with Jan and others. So they dominate global production, revenues and volumes. They control globally relevant segments of seafood production. They connect ecosystems globally through their subsidiaries, and they influence global governance processes and institutions. And when I read this, I was like, Eureka. I was like, I met all these industry people at UN meetings, at regulatory meetings. I've come across their subsidiaries and their sort of net of production through the work I've done in the Barents Sea and with the krill. So this spoke very sort of straight to sort of my heart. And I think truly sort of a unique opportunity to sort of do all this work, have this sort of scientific papers and be able to then sort of reflect upon what does it mean for me, for my work, how can I sort of put what I do in a context. But it also means that through this work and through the work that Jan is also part of, something that's called CBOS was created that I'm also part of and work with. So what is CBOS? It's the companies that dominate global seafood production, basically. So, and then some of you might have heard it from Jan. It was launched in 2017 at the UN Oceans Conference. It's a unique collaboration. I think it includes close to 30 scientists and these 10 companies. You might not have heard of all of them, but at least like some of them were sort of a bit new to me. Cargill not so maybe, Taiyun not, but I don't know Dong Wong. But I've never heard about Maori Nature before I read this paper. They're not visible in the Nordic market at all. But when you realize that that company turns around 2 million tons of seafood, you start to understand that the size of these operations. They also have over 500 different seafood species in their portfolios. They operate in 96 countries, and some of that is trading, some of that is fishing. And they are about 20% of the traded value of seafood globally. So they're truly, truly large in scale. And for me, that the work that we do in CBOS is like change work on steroids. It's sort of the amplification of like relatively small, but like I felt big project in the Barents Sea to suddenly like, whoa, we're talking about the world here and how that connects. So it's been truly nice to be able to come back. So CBOS is not part of my PhD. It's something I do on the side with Jan and others. But of course, it's very influential to the work I do with my PhD and how I think about seafood. And of course, my PhD is about transformations in the seafood industry. So that sort of comes to the core of what I work on. And sort of what I think that I have learned through this work, I think it's sort of to really stick to a vision and a long-term perspective and to develop trust between the actors that you work with. And I think if you can get the Russian fishing industry and Greenpeace to work together, I think more of us could actually, we can find more unusual collaborations or usual collaborations to work. I also think that it's like some of these challenges are very complex and you need different kinds of skills and capacities to solve them. And I think especially when you start looking into global systems of seafood trade, you can fish in the Barents Sea, ship it to the Netherlands, put it in a cold storage in Germany, process it in Poland, and then send it back to the UK like it's a, like there's so many so much complexity in the system, and if you are going to impact it to become better, because I think fishing is great and I think it's something that we could should continue to do, I just think we can do it much better. But to understand that complexity, we need different kinds of people. I also think that we all learn. And for someone coming from Greenpeace to say that I've learned a lot from McDonald's might not be like something you hear often, but I think some of the conversations I had with them has been truly like amazing. And I remember this, like after one of these negotiations, like everyone was a bit tired and people were waiting to get home, and we were like, oh, let's go to the pub. And there we sat. So the head of sustainability at the largest fishing company in Russia, the head of sustainability at McDonald's, and the three Greenpeace activists. And we almost all of us missed our connections, like our flights, because we had such a good time. But that came after sort of building that trust. But I also want to say, and even coming from Greenpeace, that science and data is at the core. You have to understand what is the system that you're working with to understand how you can interact with it and what properties of it that you can change. I also think that these unusual collaborations makes the outcomes more sustained. And it's been very nice to see how something that has been initiated had transferred into something that people all feel very proud of and maintained. And then just received an email from one of the ARC industry members in Camelar, who gave me like this full record of everything that went on in the negotiations and what people said and what was going on. That is like amazing to see how something that was very uncomfortable for them has turned into something that they're very proud of and now sort of take ownership over. I think it's also important when you do work on sustainability initiatives, like from the NGO sector, and maybe I'm a bit different than others in the NGO, like in Greenpeace, but I think it's like to connect it to existing initiatives and policy processes. Because changing the world doesn't necessarily mean that you have to do everything in a new way. I think it's also about sort of tweaking and fixing the system that we have. So if you can like sort of fast track conservation, which is partly what we tried to do in Antarctica, if we can get the fishing industry to agree with us, why should countries then not agree with us if they're the fishing industry that they're trying to protect? But then also to remember very strongly, like everyone in this is going to be outside their comfort zone. And I think Jan can also speak to that. It's like, it's almost like the more uncomfortable you are, the better placed you are to have these conversations. Because if you're comfortable, I don't think you're in the right place. And it's that kind of uncomfortableness, if you can say that, it sort of creates a really nice dynamic. And I think it also creates a space for trying to find common solutions to the problems. Even though, as I said in the beginning, I think it's also important that someone starts to create that crisis that this collaboration needs to solve. So that's my talk is over. And I always want to end with this fantastic picture of a humpback whale who thinks it's a tuna, because it's one of my favorite stories. We almost hunted these whales to extinction because we needed them for industrial, for lamps and other things. We agreed as a global community through the International Whaling Commission. It's the oldest environmental governance agreement we have. It came in for it to not hunt these whales. It's taken a very, very long time, but like a few years ago, we saw the first papers that could verify that the South Atlantic humpback whale population had recovered to pre-hunting numbers, which is such a good story. And I think it sort of shows it has the essence of sort of we can collaborate, we can do good things, but it's also going to take some time. And now there's so many humpbacks in Antarctica that you almost do get a bit tired. Oh, them, because you see them everywhere, and it's truly fantastic. But I think it's good to remind ourselves that, like, in a world where everything is a bit sort of horrible, there's also good stories out there. We should amplify them a bit more. So I have some, maybe they will be shared later, but I think ARC, if you want to read about what ARC does, and CBOS, I think Greenpeace is easy to you won't find. And then, of course, this is like great, a recent paper that came out from Henrik, I think, and Jan and myself are on it, that looks at sort of keystone actors and biosphere stewardship and someone like goes through some of the work that we've done.